The most simple way to store energy in chemical bonds is the use of hydrogen. However, hydrogen is a gas and difficult to store and transport. In the long run, we would rather have a liquid as a means of chemical storage. In this way, we could use the current energy infrastructure, which is largely based on liquid fuels such as oil. To make this possible, we have to design processes to bind hydrogen with other molecules, for instance, nitrogen or CO2, carbon dioxide. The latter would be beneficial in order to reverse the global warming. Especially since the 50s of the last century, the temperature has been steadily rising. In fact, in 2016, it was the warmest year on record since 1880, and 2017 is again on pace to break this record once again. The primary cause for global warming and climate change is the rise of the CO2 concentration in the air due to the burning of fossil resources. We might be able to reverse this trend if we would be able to withdraw CO2 from the atmosphere and use it as a feedstock. The capture of CO2 from the atmosphere is a topic in itself, and here it suffices to say that this is indeed possible. Hence, by using CO2 from air and combined with hydrogen made from electrolysis of water, we can make molecules such as methane, ethylene, formic acid or carbon monoxide in a completely sustainable way. This results in a circular economy powered by the sun. In fact, chemists know already for a century how to make hydrocarbons from CO2 and water. However, in conventional plants, we need fossil fuels to power the reactions. In the future, we will power such reactions by renewably produced electricity. The present energy system is dominated by fossil fuels, which are convenient energy carriers. Only a small fraction of these fuels is converted into electricity. In the future, we envisage a world dominated by PV and wind power. This world will be dominated by electric power. However, a proportion of this power will need to be converted to so-called solar fuels. Basically, to make CO2 neutral fuels, we consider the following steps. First, we need to split water into hydrogen and oxygen using electrolysis, which we discussed previously. Then we combine hydrogen and CO2 in a chemical process plant to produce the hydrocarbon molecules. The chemical process plant is conventionally powered by fossil fuel. Ideally, one would like to merge the two processes into one electrochemical process using the sun as the only power source. This indeed can be done in an aqueous electrochemical cell, which is flushed by CO2. At the platinum electrode, water is split into oxygen gas and protons. The protons move to the other electrode, and at the silver electrodes, the dissolved CO2 reacts with the protons and the electrons supplied to form CO and water. The overall reaction is obtained by adding these two so-called half reactions. We find that indeed it corresponds to the conversion of CO2 and water into CO and oxygen. To form hydrocarbons, the other catalyst materials are needed, such as copper. In contrast to electrochemical water splitting, the electrochemical conversion of CO2 into hydrocarbons is not yet a commercial process. The reason is that this process is energetically very inefficient. Moreover, a selective electrode to deliver only the conversion reaction required is yet to be found. As a result, it is now the focus of a lot of research worldwide to explore the periodic table and discover the electrode materials that could do the trick in a stable, selective, and efficient way. Alternatively, we can make other CO2 neutral fuels, such as ammonia. Again, we first split water into hydrogen and oxygen using electrolysis, as we discussed previously. Then we combine hydrogen and nitrogen in a chemical process plant. Nitrogen can be easily produced by cooling air to its condensation temperature. And in the chemical process plant, the two molecules may react to form ammonia. Again, ammonia can be stored, now in a liquid form, and can be easily transformed back into hydrogen and nitrogen. Apart from serving as an energy storage means, ammonia is also an important feedstock to produce artificial fertilizer. However, also in this case, one would like to merge the two into one electrochemical process. Here we consider the electrolytic production of ammonia, assuming the electricity is provided by a solar or wind energy. In this case, the geometry is different from water electrolysis. Again, we observe an electrolyte which provides for the transport of protons. In this case, gaseous reactants and products are fed at the outside of the electrodes. At the right side, water molecules are split into oxygen molecule and protons. At the left side, the protons combine with nitrogen gas and an electron powered by the electric circuit to form ammonia. Summing both half reactions, we find that one nitrogen molecule reacts with three water molecules to form ammonia and oxygen. Finally, we are at the end of this series of videos on energy storage. We have described the various ways to deal with the fact that sustainable electricity sources are fluctuating. How to select the right storage solution? We could approach this question from various angles: investment costs, use of scarce materials, etc. Here, we focus on efficiency and availability. Since storage conversion processes always imply losses, one should first look at smart grid solutions and improve the connectivity of the network. Storage will still be required to cover for the remaining mismatch between demand and supply. Electrical storage in general has a good cycle efficiency, but it is a very expensive solution and it is often not suited for long-term storage due to its volatility. On the other hand, mechanical solutions are geographically very limited, while heat storage requires enormous volumes. Energy storage in chemical bonds will always imply substantial conversion losses, which increase with the complexity of the molecule formed. However, given its high density and non-volatility, we will need this form of storage to provide the world with both fuel and resources.